We've worked with AMD from the beginning. We've worked really closely with their engineers, and I think the final result really shows that.
I've been working with an engineer helping us to improve performance. He knows the AMD GPU inside out.
When we were first looking at, can we get this to 4K? We were struggling for a while to get it up there, and then we turned Mantle on and got that support, and then it just works.
At those kinds of resolutions, the last barriers to any sorts of immersion fall away and feel like you're in a picture.
We're showing Crescent Bay, which is our flagship prototype that is demonstrating the promise of VR. We're showing this on the flagship Radeon graphics chipset.
AMD is uniquely positioned to actually deliver the promise of VR for the coming years because we have the right DNA to do that.
The nice thing about the AMD stuff is if it isn't 4K for you, it could be Infinity. You might have multiple lower resolution monitors at home.
This is Ashes of Singularity, and it's a new strategy game we're working on. So thanks to Mantle and as well as DirectX 12, we're going to see completely new classes of games that we can't even imagine.
Welcome the Chief Gaming Officer, Richard Huddy.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Thank you so much. Well, good morning to those of you who are in the US here with us. Good afternoon to those of us who are in that kind of time zone and all around the world. Many, many people joining us on Twitch. So welcome here today. Thank you so much for joining us to talk a little about PC gaming. Chief Gaming Officer or Chief Gaming Scientist, either of those job titles will do. First of all, we're going to spend about an hour going over gaming. PC gaming primarily, I'll make one or two mentions of consoles and so on, but fundamentally this is a celebration of where we stand with PC gaming and where we're going with PC gaming. I am Richard Huddy, Chief Gaming Scientist at AMD, a role I am delighted to hold. We're coming to you live this morning from the Belasco Theater here in downtown Los Angeles, just a short walk from the largest video game show in the world, E3. If you care about PC gaming, and I trust you do, if you don't, what are you doing here? But I trust that you do, then you are definitely in the right place. We're going to give you everything that you want. Everything I hear you say? Yes, everything. You said you wanted the world's fastest graphics performance. You are going to get it. You said you wanted the world's most power-efficient graphics cards. Today, you will get that. You said you wanted us to partner with some of the biggest titles of the year, and you will hear all about that too. You said you wanted revolutionary form factors, things that let you do exciting new things with the PCs that you want to build. You will get that too. And for those of you who forgot to ask, you're also going to get one or two painful puns from Richard. Today we're going to show you some of the most exciting next-gen games from Stardock, from Lionhead, from CCP, from Electronic Arts, including what I believe is the most anticipated game of the year, Star Wars Battlefront, a fantastic partnership that we're really delighted to announce. And in fact, today we're going to show you the first ever footage of the PC version of Star Wars Battlefront. We'll run that live today. Really cool. And we have more than just games. We're going to show you a whole bunch of new PC gaming tech, including the latest in VR from Oculus and from GE. We're going to show you some of the latest developments from Microsoft on how they're making PC games even better, the excitement that is DirectX 12, Windows 10. And we have a jam-packed hour. You're not going to want to miss a minute of it. So please, let's get going. All right. Now, I'm talking about a new era. I better make clear exactly what I think that is. And today, we know that there are hundreds of millions, literally hundreds of millions of gamers playing esports titles. These are games like League of Legends, Dota 2, and there are tens of millions of dollars in prize money up for grabs for these competitions all around the world. We're seeing an expanding reach of PC gaming like never before. And those PC gamers, quite rightly, want a great and reliable experience on a PC. And for many of them, for hundreds of millions of them, quite rightly, they want to game on a budget. What we're playing has changed. And at the same time, how we are playing has changed. We've seen some incredible new PC gaming experiences taking hold. Resolutions are going up and up, 4K, 5K, and beyond. We actually have a 5K monitor on the screen here, first one to my right. and displays are very, very much more affordable. Those 4K monitors that used to be $1,000, $1,500, $2,000, now $400, $500, $600. PC gamers care about smooth frame rates just as much as they do about high frame rates. Smooth frame rates rather than just high frame rates. And to solve that, AMD released FreeSync technology. It's an open standards-based solution that brings stutter-free gaming to all, not just released, but very much a product that's widely available these days out in the market. One of the most important changes for 2015, the new next-gen APIs, DX12 and Vulkan. They're going to bring stunning new realism to gamers, faster and to a wider variety of platforms than ever before. We're seeing a really great transition to DX12. DX12 gaming is going to be a phenomenal, phenomenal experience. And we've seen VR-related console announcements. You've seen those from Microsoft and from Sony over the last week or so. VR is also coming to PC in an awfully big way. VR demands, well, let's be fair, VR demands are different depending on the system. For some people, if you want a Samsung Gear VR, you can get a VR experience, which is quite a lot of fun, but a radically different kind of experience from what we talk about on the PC. There, you typically want an awful lot of horsepower. You want exceptionally high frame rates. You need to deliver that to both eyes and absolutely minimal latency, typically something along the lines of 10 or 11 milliseconds. And AMD has been contributing to that over 2015 with a new SDK, Liquid VR, a set of technologies that make VR as comfortable, efficient, and easy to use as possible for everyone, for games players and for games developers. These are amazing experiences. And gamers who want all of this are going to need new, powerful graphics hardware to be ready for this revolution. That's the new era of PC gaming we're talking about today. 4K gaming, VR, loads and loads of horsepower that's required. So we will start with the introduction of the base of the range. So this is the R7 300 series. Over to my left, to get the most from this new era of PC gaming, no matter what your game, AMD is thrilled to announce this next generation line of Radeon graphics cards, the AMD R9 and R7 series cards over here to my left. Here to tell us all about them is AMD's Devin Nekerchuk. Devin, welcome to the stage, please. Hey, Devin, how are you?
I'm doing well. How about you?
I'm good. And I'm with the crowd. Devin, woo! Okay, so I just mentioned the huge popularity of online sports. Maybe a good idea to quantify that. We say 700 million people are playing games around the world, that kind of stuff. Huge amount of people. What have you got for us that's going to be perfect as an experience for these esports players? So we're specifically talking about esports players rather than the crazy folks like me who love Crysis and so on.
Yeah, and I think you summarized it nicely. There are hundreds of millions of people around the world that play these esports titles. And what are they going to need? They need a graphics card in their system that gives them the best experience when playing these games. So one of the first things I want to talk about today is a new series of graphics cards that we're launching called the Radeon R7 300 series of products. And if we actually move over here,
shall we?
I can show you a couple of them. So what we have here, this is a series of products that we've created to give you the best experience in online games and these esports titles. Mm-hmm. And these gamers, they typically play their games at 1080p resolution.
Which is what we have here, yeah?
Yeah, so what we're showing here is Dota 2. Mm-hmm. These games, they're competitive, right? So you want to not stutter. You want to crank up your settings. You want to run at maximum detail and have a competitive gaming experience. You don't want your graphics card to slow you down. Mm-hmm. And we've created two products to enable it.
Okay, and these cards, I've talked about the future being DX12, things like that. These cards will also support DX12?
Yeah, every card I'm going to talk about today is built on AMD's Graphics Core Next technology and will run Microsoft's DirectX 12.
Awesome, okay. So what features did you put into the cards for this? This is a product launch, so obviously we're going to have to create a certain amount of pain with some new acronyms. What have you got for us there?
Okay, so the first new feature that's really cool on these graphics cards, it's called Frame Rate Target Control.
FRTC.
FRTC. Mm-hmm. And if you think about these games, some of them are actually able to run at hundreds of frames per second. And your graphics card typically renders a couple hundred per second. It might put 60 up on your display, but it throws the rest away.
Okay.
So let's do that a little bit smarter. Let's be more intelligent. And instead of rendering, say, 400 frames every second and throwing away 340 of them, let's render those 60. and then go into a sleep mode and not render those extra 340 that are not being displayed, you get to save power, your graphics card's going to run cooler, and it's going to be quieter than it would otherwise.
We like that. Less intrusive graphics cards.
So it makes it a very nice, silent, cool, and quiet gaming experience.
Very cool indeed. Acronym number one out of the way. Number two.
So two is another cool feature if you're interested in getting more detail on your screen. This is Virtual Super Resolution, or VSR. Now, I mentioned that these gamers, when you buy a graphics card in this range, you're probably running on a 1080p display. And what Virtual Super Resolution lets you do is get the game rendering at a higher resolution, like 25x14, or even something close to 4K resolution.
Okay.
And then the graphics card will downscale that image, it will fit it onto your 1080p panel, and give you a level of detail above and beyond what you would get typically rendering this at native 1080p resolution.
That's very cool. So you get a higher quality experience, even though you're only running on a 1080p monitor, you get a display that has been rendered at higher quality.
Yeah, exactly. And as I mentioned, these cards, some games will run at hundreds of frames per second on them. So let's use that graphics horsepower to deliver better visual quality on screen.
Very nice indeed. Okay, so why don't you take us through the product range itself?
Okay, we have two products in the R7 300 series. The first one I want to announce is called the Radeon R7 360. This is for your entry-level online gaming experience. It will be available for prices as low as $109 and will be equipped with up to 2 GB of memory.
Now, I'm used to a bigger, beefier graphics card than that in my PC. That, I guess, will go into almost any PC that's ever been made.
Yeah, this is a very low-power product. It's a very small form factor, so there's some cool cases out there that you can fit this into.
Okay.
Or if you already have a system and you're upgrading, then this will be a great upgrade that will fit into almost any chassis.
Okay, so that's the R7 360. Yeah.
Now, you might want to crank up to some more intensive games. You might want to play some higher level of detail. And for that, we've created the AMD Radeon R7 370. This graphics card not only delivers more performance, but will come equipped with up to 4 GB of GDDR5 memory. This product will be available for $149 and above.
So 4 GB is enough. Many people talk about 1080p, not 1080p, 4K gaming requiring 4 GB. That will actually give you a decent bite at those games, yeah?
Definitely. This card is equipped with that memory so that it's future-proof, and you can run features like Virtual Super Resolution and make sure that you have the memory to drive those higher resolutions.
Very nice. And fully DX12 compliant, everything you need.
Absolutely.
Awesome. Okay. So what if we want something a little bit more powerful still for the insatiable amongst us?
So these games, these are the most popular in the world, but they're not the most graphically intensive. So if you're the type of gamer that wants to run something a little bit more heavy, a little bit more intensive, maybe you're also the kind of gamer that wants to step up from 1080p resolution, mm-hmm. run your games at 1440p, at 4K, cranking up the settings.
Yeah.
Or there's some cool display technologies out there, like FreeSync technology and some high refresh rate displays that run at 144 hertz.
Yeah, yeah.
So for those gamers, we've created the AMD Radeon R9 series of graphics cards. And we have a couple products here in the R9 series that I want to talk about.
Okay.
So the first product in the R9 series is the AMD Radeon R9 380. This is a graphics card that delivers enough performance to drive gaming at 1440p resolutions. So if you're the kind of gamer that is interested in FreeSync, if you're running at 1440p, this is a great gaming card for you.
2 gig, 4 gig?
This card will be available starting at $199.
Okay.
It will come equipped with up to 4 GB of GDDR5 memory.
Very nice. Okay, so definitely kitted out for that kind of resolution.
But some gamers want to push that even harder, right? There's some gorgeous 4K displays out there, and if you're gaming on 4K, you need a lot of graphics horsepower to push all those pixels.
Mm-hmm.
So for that, we've created the R9 390 series of graphics cards. So there's two members of this family. There's the R9 390 and the R9 390X graphics card. These will be available at $329 and $429.
Okay.
Both of these cards come with 8 GB of GDDR5. That means you can run at 4K, you can run high resolution texture packs, you can really push these cards hard, and they will have enough memory to deliver a great experience.
Okay, and you've nailed those prices to the dollar, so I guess these are actually available fairly soon, yeah?
Yeah, so these products will be available for purchase on Thursday. So check out your retailers, check out your stores. You should be able to get these in stores very soon. In fact, we're actually doing a giveaway with Mass Luminosity, and you can get a whole system kitted out with some 390X graphics cards. Just follow our social channels, and you should be able to see the details for that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very cool. And actually, I heard there was a lot of excitement about this. One or two retailers allowed slightly early access over this weekend. That's how much buzz there is around this this new Radeon series.
I think we've kept most of these details pretty good under wraps. but I'm really looking forward to seeing what people say about these and how they experience them coming on Thursday.
Okay, and I should ask you, just in case, full on DX12 support?
Yeah, so let me spend some time on that. These cards will all support DirectX 12 because they're built on AMD's Graphics Core Next technology. And while DirectX 12 might not mean that much to you right now, it might just sound like a funny acronym or a funny name, it's actually going to change the way you game. So what I think we need to look at is how will DirectX 11 change the gaming experience? It's going to enable the next level of visual detail. It's going to enable more objects on scene, on screen, more units. It's really going to enable these next generation games to look even better and play even better than before, especially when looking at these high resolutions like 4K. It's really revolutionary, and we've been working really hard to make sure that our products fully support DirectX 12.
It's one of the most exciting things that's happening in 2015, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
Microsoft recently went through the release timetable. We're talking July 29th, so a month or so away. Awesome stuff. Do you want to take us through a little more detail?
Absolutely, and I actually have some experts that I can invite up on stage to dive into exactly what DirectX 12 will mean for you.
Let me give you some space for that. Thank you, Devin.
Thank you. So with that, I would like to invite up Cam Vidbrat from Microsoft. I would like to invite up Raymond Arifianto from Lionhead Studios. And I would like to invite up Adam Biesner from Stardock. So Cam, Microsoft has been integral and synonymous with PC gaming for decades, right?
Yeah, we have. And you know, it's been quite a while since the last time we said, hey, you know, how are we going to rethink graphics? And if you think about the number of years since we shipped D3D 11, a lot has gone by. And so when we sat down to design DX 12, we wanted to make sure we were really delivering the best graphics API for game developers on modern gaming hardware. And so when we think about a modern gaming PC, you think about multiple cores, you think about a GPU that has some pretty advanced features like asynchronous compute and more dynamic resource binding. And the API really lets game developers get a lot more control over how their game runs on the PC as a result of this. And the wins that they get from this are very real. So, you know, in some of the workloads that we've measured as we've worked with developers to kind of port games over, we see things like up to 50% reduction in CPU usage per frame. We see much better multi-core scalability and real GPU wins as well, 20% performance wins on GPU. So it's a real boost for the gaming experience.
So how's the rollout going for you? Obviously, you have to work with developers. You have to get the content out there. How's that going?
You know, it's been really wonderful to see the reception that we've gotten with the game development community. We have an early access program that we've talked about a number of times over the last couple of years. We've got over 100 game studios involved in early access. And the appeal has been really strong and really global. You know, I look at some of the games that the game developers we've interacted with, where they're located and what types of titles they've produced. We've got a developer in China called Snail Games that announced a title called Kings of Wushu at our build conference earlier this year. The Lionhead folks are in the UK. Stardock is here in the US. You know, we've got really broad appeal, and everyone's been very, very supportive and very happy with it.
So from what I've seen so far, it is creating some outstanding graphics in these games. When can gamers actually get their hands on this? When will they be able to play around with either DirectX 12 or the games that use DirectX 12?
DirectX 12 ships with Windows 10 later this summer, and you'll start to see games show up shortly after the operating system comes out, and you'll see the real big kind of influx of games around holiday and then early next year as well.
Cool. So yeah, you hit a key point there, and that's that these developers are key, and I think developers are pretty excited about this new level of graphics technology. So, Raymond, you guys at Lionhead, you've been working on Unfable, and you're quite familiar with DirectX 12.
Yes.
So I think we actually have some content up here. So while we play that, why don't you walk us through what is Fable and what has your experience with DirectX 12 been?
Cool. So when we first started working on Fable Legends, we knew that we have to translate what is this beautiful world of Albion into, you know, what can we do with it in the next generation of hardware. So that's why we're super excited that when Microsoft announced that the DirectX 12 is coming and partners like AMD coming up with the GPUs that's actually going to support it. As you can tell, at Lionhead we have been playing with DirectX 12. We're just getting started, but we're finding out amazing things that we can do with it. One of the features that we are most excited about is the asynchronous shader. That's basically your ability to run certain compute jobs such as dynamic GI and physics simulation in parallel to the rest of the rendering. And what we're also finding out is the AMD GCN has been amazing to do those things. One example is we find that our indirect lighting cost, we can actually reduce it by 33% in some cases. That's cool, right? And also what we're finding is some fine-grained compute jobs, such as instance calling, for instance, suddenly became virtually free. That is basically extra GPU power that we can consume without compromising on the performance of the game.
So that's a lot of technical jargon.
Right.
And I want to know, you're showing in-game cinematics here, right?
Well, this is actually in-game gameplay that's actually running on DX12.
So this is what the game will look like when you run it in DX12.
And this is just, we're just getting started with this, and we're just going to continually improve it.
Cool. So all that technical stuff you talked about,
sure.
How does that impact the actual gaming experience?
Sure. PC gamers, we understand PC gamers. PC gamers are different from console gamers in the way that they want to invest on what's cool, and they do want to invest on actually getting the best experience. And we want to use up as much as we can all the resources that we have available to make a more realistic monsters, a bigger world. So we're very excited about what we can do.
Cool. When can gamers get their hands on this?
Our Xbox beta is actually available right now, and Windows 10 beta is actually coming very, very soon. So sign up at fablelegends.com.
Very cool. I'm looking forward to playing around with that.
Thank you.
So, Adam, first of all, congratulations on Galactic Civilization 3.
Thank you.
But while you guys have launched that, you've been toiling away in the background on Ashes of the Singularity, an upcoming RTS, right?
Yeah, so Ashes of the Singularity is our upcoming massive-scale sci-fi RTS being developed by Oxide Games, and we are super excited about it. It's got all the RTS staples that players expect, right? It's got base building, resource management, technology upgrades, all that kind of stuff. But using all of the new technology that's coming out, all the latest stuff, we're able to take the whole concept of a large-scale RTS and really redefine that as a next-generation experience.
Cool. So yeah, it's really taking it to the next level with the X12. Can you tell us a bit about what we're seeing here?
Yeah, so unlike past large-scale RTSs, which had to make some compromises, rendering units as 2D icons when you zoom out and making other visual and AI compromises, using the latest technology like DirectX 12 and AMD's next generation Radeon graphics cards, we're able to not make any compromises and really make the game that exists in our heads exist on screen.
Mm-hmm. So generally when you hear about DirectX 12, it's in the context of the graphics, it's the rendering, it's the visual quality. But you guys are doing more. You're changing the actual gameplay. So can you tell us how it affects that gaming experience?
Yeah, so what next generation RTS means to us is three things. First, it's massive scale, right? We're able to put 1,000 units under the player's control that are engaged in warfare, not a smaller number of units that are engaged in battles, right? And the cool thing is that you can see all those and have that whole experience no matter how far you zoom out. And have that whole experience no matter how far you... Right? The second thing is visual fidelity. We have thousands of light sources active at any one time. Every laser bolt, every missile, every explosion is a light source that's affecting everything around it all the time, right? And the third thing is smarter AI. Now, because we use multi-core CPUs to their fullest potential with the Nitrous engine that Oxide built, we have kind of all this extra CPU power that has traditionally been left on the table, and that lets us run more complex unit AI. One of the ways that we're taking advantage of that is a feature we call battle groups. Battle groups are, you can put a bunch of units together into a battle group. Once they're there, then they move together in smart formations, they fight together and support each other intelligently. So that frees up the player's attention to developing tactics to win the larger war.
Very cool. So what time frame are we looking at on this? When can gamers actually play it?
So we're pleased to announce that Thursday, players will be able to join our Founders Alpha. It's available directly from Stardock at ashesgame.com. Now, it's an alpha, so don't come in expecting a polished or finished gameplay experience, but we're really excited to get it into players' hands for the first time out of our development environment.
Very cool. So all of the DX12 content will run on these products that we just announced, the Radeon R7 300 series and the Radeon R9 300 series. So with that, thank you guys. Ladies and gentlemen, Cam from Microsoft, Raymond from Lionhead, Adam from Stardock. Hi, Chess. And now let me bring it back over to Richard.
Thank you, Devin. Thank you very much. Really great. Okay, so DirectX 12 is obviously going to make a massive impact on PC gaming over the next year and well into the future. But another technology that's already making quite a lot of waves is virtual reality, or VR. If you've been one of the lucky few to own or try an Oculus Rift, actually I say lucky few, but I understand they've shipped a pretty respectable number of these SDKs, then you'll know that you feel like you are literally there in the world. You'll feel a sense of vertigo that no PC game will ever give you. With a PC game looking at a monitor, there is a sense in which it feels like you're looking into a window into the world. And just like when you watch a movie, you have to go through this active and willing suspension of disbelief. The thing about a really convincing VR experience is that you no longer have to make any kind of emotional or intellectual step there. Suddenly it's all done for you. You really are there in the experience. I've seen people jump in their seats. I've seen people squeal. I've seen people lean back in the middle of a perfectly safe room, lean back frightened that they will fall down the abyss behind them. It's a really, really compelling experience. And if you haven't had a chance to try it, then please do a search on YouTube for something like Oculus Affected, and you'll actually come up with some really great experiences that have been filmed and which are available for you to review. But the most impactful thing you can do, try it yourself, obviously. So here to tell us where VR is going, we're going to ask a couple of guests onto the stage. I'm going to ask Anuj Gosalia of Oculus, makers of the Oculus Rift, and Ryan Geddes of CCP, developers of Eve Valkyrie. Ryan, welcome. And Anuj, a pleasure to see you. So, let's start with the basics, if we can. Anuj, let's dig into some of the technicalities of VR. Okay, so you care about the experience in the end, but it's all built on technicalities, and it's worth taking a look at just how difficult it is, this wizardry that you guys are putting together. So one of the terms that we hear in every conversation about VR at the moment is presence, this idea that you are genuinely in there. And I talked about it as if it were a difference between looking in through a window and actually being there. Take us through what it is that you need for presence and what it is to you.
So yeah, thank you, Richard. Presence is this sense of feeling that you're really someplace else. It is impossible to explain this without truly trying to experience it yourself. We believe it will enable a player to enter a game or an environment and really feel like they're actually there in that game. This will really enable people to unlock new virtual reality gaming experiences. And it is, you know, when I first tried the Oculus Rift with Oculus Touch, and to be able to be there in a virtual environment and see your own hands and interact and pick up objects, like picking up a toy gun and being able to aim it at a target, it just felt so completely natural. And that was just an incredible experience.
Well, the human sensors are pretty aware of little differences in cues from various things. So what you're trying to produce sounds like it's going to be technically very challenging, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, we are pushing the limits of the operating system and the GPUs to the fullest to get maximum performance at the lowest latency possible.
Now, you make an important point there. You talk about latency. Typically, in PC gaming, we talk about frame rate, but it's a different thing to you, yeah?
That's right. It's a different trade-off here. And so to achieve this, we had to collaborate closely with Microsoft and the GPU vendors. For example, we've been working with AMD to make the experience of connecting a headset to the PC seamless. We're also partnering with AMD to make sure that our software with their drivers has the lowest latency path to the hardware. To achieve this, we are using Liquid VR to get access to the accelerated compute engine, which allows us to do instantaneous access to the GPU and schedule work to it really quickly.
Yeah, Cam talked about that, and he was obviously pretty excited about it, too. To go into it in a lot of technical detail would take us a few hours or so, but it is an extraordinary thing. You will see sometimes that you can use those asynchronous compute engines to do work, and it appears to take no time, and it can overtake other work in the queue when it's done properly. It's a pretty spectacular thing from a programmer's point of view.
Right, yeah. And also, with Liquid VR's multi-GPU support, you can now have multiple GPUs speeding up the rendering of VR without adding any extra latency.
Indeed, because a traditional crossfire setup adds latency even though it delivers higher frame rates, so there is a trade-off. But with Liquid VR, there is no trade-off. You're just getting the best out of the system, yeah?
That's right. And so this will enable the highest-end VR experiences.
Very nice indeed. Okay, so Oculus has come quite a long way from its Kickstarter days. Then you didn't have to worry about an actual product. Now you care a lot. You've gone through a recent announcement about the launch and so on. Why don't you take us through the actual products that you're going to bring to market and a little about the timetable, if you could, please.
Yeah. So we've so far shipped about 150,000 dev kits. And last week, we announced two products that we're going to be shipping next year. First one is the Oculus Rift, which many of you may have heard about. It's a new virtual reality system. That one, we're going to be announcing that we just announced that we will be shipping that in Q1 2016.
And important to understand, this is not a complete system. You plug it into a PC and there are some other parts with it, yeah.
That's right.
Okay.
And we have the final consumer form factor of the Oculus Rift that we are demonstrating along with a whole bunch of new gaming experiences at E3 that you can check out. In addition to the Oculus Rift, we also announced the Oculus Touch, which is a new pair of track controllers that will take VR experiences to the next level. With ability to see your hands and interact in a virtual environment is really going to unlock new VR experiences that have not been possible before. And we think that this is going to be a big enabler to delivering presence. So Oculus Touch is also something that we will be demonstrating as a prototype that we call Half Moon at our booth at E3.
Very nice indeed. Very nice indeed. OK, now I mentioned you need a PC to use this. That means that you need to lay down some minimum specs, I guess. What kind of graphics do you tend to require for a good experience?
Yeah, so we will be requiring graphics performance is really important for VR. Missing frame rate in VR is really bad. And low latency is absolutely required. And in VR, it's really easy to see graphics quality. All of this really makes GPU performance absolutely critical. So our required recommended specification for VR is AMD R9 290 and above class of GPUs. What you guys have announced today are some really exciting new products that are going to be awesome for the demands of VR. And so we are really looking forward to working with AMD and GPU and PC manufacturers to bringing all this amazing technology to consumer PCs.
Awesome. Okay. So thank you, Anuj. That sounds like a pretty exciting ride that you've been on. And we are wildly excited about not only working with you, but actually getting some of these final kits in our hands.
Thank you for that.
Need a little bit more than just AMD's cool drivers and a spectacular headset and all the rest of the kit that goes there. You need the rest of it. You need the software. You need the content. So that's why we have you, CCP, on stage, Ryan. You're going to take us through a little bit about Eve Valkyrie. Take us into the universe, if you would, while it plays behind us.
Sure. So Eve Valkyrie is a multiplayer online space dogfighting shooter set in the Eve universe and really built from the ground up for VR. This game was born in VR. What we really want to do is unlock what Anuj is talking about in terms of presence and immersion, and really putting you in the cockpit of that spaceship, launching you out of that tube, and just having you be there. There's nothing like looking down and seeing your body in that cockpit, looking around, seeing these spaceships flying all around you, missiles exploding, people on your tail. It's really the essence of space dogfighting, and we can only do that with VR, and we're really excited about unlocking that for players.
So you have to do more in Eve Valkyrie to do a great VR experience than you would in just a regular PC game.
Absolutely. I mean, not only is there no room for things like latency and lag and all those things that make the experience not immersive, but everything is different in VR. I mean, it changes the way you think about cover, the way you think about tactics, the way you think about teamwork. We're sort of on the cutting edge here with VR technology and the kinds of experiences we can make. So we're really taking that level of polish, that level of AAA production, everything we do at CCP, and bringing it into VR and giving people an experience that makes them forget they're not actually sitting in the cockpit of a spaceship.
Awesome, awesome. And some beautiful footage running up behind us. Those of you who get the opportunity should absolutely take every chance you get to experience this even before the game is released, but I guess we care. When is the game going to be released?
Q1 2016.
Awesome, awesome. We look forward to it very much. So Ryan?
Thank you.
Anuj, thank you so much for coming to us and talking to us about virtual reality. Thank you. Okay. Now, if you think it takes a lot of GPU brains to play Eve Valkyrie in virtual reality, you ain't seen nothing yet. VR is absolutely opening the door to some incredible new gaming experiences, but it is also posed to dramatically transform a whole bunch of other applications. We certainly see more than just gaming for our GPUs. Simulation, entertainment, education, travel, healthcare, all sorts of opportunities to use this software for all sorts of different functions. Now, GE does a tremendous amount of work in healthcare, and they ask themselves a straightforward question, one that I haven't asked myself before, but maybe I should have done. What would it look like if you could look inside the human brain and you could explore a brain, see how it works from every angle in VR? And that's what GE researchers have answered with an incredible new VR experience called Neuro. To talk about it, please welcome to the stage Katrina Craigwell from GE. Katrina, welcome. Good to see you.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm good. How are you?
Good. Very well. Hello.
Okay, so really simple. Tell me a little about Neuro. What is this?
So GE has been in the neuroscience space since the early 80s, especially around brain imaging. Mm-hmm. One of our scientists did the first brain image test in an MRI machine on himself. It went well, it succeeded, and so we continued in the space. And when we think about it, our understanding of the brain is decades behind our understanding of the other organs in our bodies. And so we have work to do to map the unmapped mind, to bring together the neuroscience community, to develop the strongest imaging technology out there, high resolution, high definition, and make that available to doctors and researchers to deal with things like brain injury and neurological disease, but also make it available to the public so that we can understand how this machine that's sitting on top of our heads is working. When we think about the stories of GE, they're incredibly complex, deep stories about science and technology, and virtual reality is giving us a new way to make that available to people in ways that they'll never forget.
Indeed, absolutely. Okay, so earlier you heard Oculus and you heard CCP talk about presence.
Yes.
What is presence to you, GE, in this neuro experience?
When we think about it, we think it's with any experience, whether gaming or content, it's very important that the user is comfortable and that the user wants to stay in an experience for 2, 3, 6, 7 minutes, play a game for hours, and that the visuals and the world that they're in feels responsive and it feels real. And it's, so it's critical for the work that we're doing.
Terrific. OK. And what about a high-powered GPU? Is that a big deal to you
folks, too? Absolutely. So when you, when you look at some of the shots from this experience, and you really have to see it in the headset, it's about 7 minutes long. But we wanted to celebrate the imagination. We had we worked with our character, DJ Ruben Wu, who is a friend of GE and has done work with us in the past. Mm-hmm. And so we created a couple of worlds to celebrate his imagination, then go a layer deeper. And from what we know about brain anatomy, rebuild that in a virtual environment and rebuild. So you know, when you get into the deepest layer, mm-hmm. you're up close with a neural network, and you're seeing neurons that are the size of your body as you're in the experience, and they are beautiful and high definition and very comfortable. And we couldn't have built it without the AMD graphics cards, and we couldn't have built it without Liquid VR.
Ah, so you mentioned Liquid VR there for me. Liquid VR is about delivering that that software experience that is slick and smooth and problem-free. You guys look at that right now, yeah?
Absolutely. So we're running the experience. We're running it upstairs on Liquid VR and on the AMD systems, and we're going to be using them across the board at GE events and when we take it on the road.
Excellent, excellent. OK, really impressive stuff, though I have to admit that one or two people have said to me it's not going to take a full-on GPU to emulate my brain. It can probably be done with a modest calculator.
Well, we'll see.
Or maybe just an abacus, who knows. But really wonderful. Katrina, thank you so
thank
much
you.
For joining us. Thank you. OK, so multiple interesting uses for VR. That's just one look at one other possibility. But really incredible stuff. We've taken a look at 4K. Mentioned that we've got at least one 4K monitor out here. We've looked at DirectX 12 in a decent amount of depth now. And as I say, we've seen some pretty amazing VR experiences. But what if you're a gamer who wants more than that? Not satisfied with just a little bit better, but really an aspirational gamer. What if, as good as the Radeon R9 300 series is, you want to know that you've got the absolute best, that you have the fastest graphics performance in the world? What if you want something that's different and flat out cooler than any of your colleagues, any of your friends, any of your family has ever had before? Something that's different, something that is really, really tuned for high resolution, high quality DX12 gaming. What then?
Well, Richard, I may have just the thing for you.
Welcome to the stage, please. Chris Hook, in that unstaged moment. Chris Hook, Director of Marketing with AMD. Hey, Chris.
Good to see you.
How are you?
It's good to be here, Richard. Well, you know, Richard, we've been talking about a new era in PC Gamer, and I'm really excited to be here today because I'm about to unveil the coolest, most exciting PC that we've ever made at AMD.
You can do a thing like that?
Apparently, yeah, I can.
Okay.
I'm excited. I'll tell you, I'm really excited about this, you know. But first of all, Richard, I'm a really big gamer, and I love gaming on my desktop tower PC in the basement.
Sure.
But you know, and don't tell my wife this, I just ordered a 4K TV for the living room.
Yeah, my wife wouldn't let me do it.
Yeah, so let's just make sure to the 25,000 people who are online right now, don't say anything
Nobody
about
tell
this.
Tell our wives, please, yeah.
But, you know, I challenged AMD's engineering team. I said, look, give me all the performance that you get in a desktop tower PC, but put it in something small and compact and beautiful, something that I can put in my living room, something that's going to deliver 60 frames a second in the latest games to my 4K TV, something that, you know, in the not-too-distant future when I manage to get the Oculus Crescent Bay headsets in there too, that we're delivering 90 FPS there as well. So how do I do that? So I challenged the engineering team to build the ultimate small form factor PC, and they delivered. Presenting to you Project Quantum. So
okay.
I'm really, really excited about this, and I'm just going to lift it up here so you guys can see it. All of the processing technology is in the bottom, and in the top, that's where we've got all the cooling solutions. So it's whisper quiet, it's engineered and tooled out of beautiful materials, aluminum and magnesium. And let's be clear, there isn't just one of AMD's next generation Fiji processors in there. In fact, there's two.
In this PC, which is roughly console size,
That's right. There are two of these Fiji PCs and these Fiji processors inside the Project Quantum PC. And we're going to be working with our most elite partners to bring this to market in the not too distant future.
So it's conceivable that this is the most powerful PC on the planet right now. And it certainly outclasses 99.99% of PCs. Yeah?
I think so. I definitely think so. And, you know, Richard, I think that's going to have to come home with me tonight.
I think it's going to have to come home with me tonight.
We'll talk. We're going to talk about that.
Okay.
This really is emblematic, Richard, of the kinds of exciting new form factors that are going to be made possible as a result of HBM and the space-saving power of HBM and all of the great engineering that our engineering team did with Fiji. So let's roll the tape.
Let's take a look at this.
When we think about products, it's about innovation and breakthroughs and, you know, choosing those areas where we can do something special.
When you look at AMD's strategic vision, it's about providing phenomenal experiences for our customers.
Innovative design is really important to us.
You know, as we were designing Fiji, we were really thinking about how do we take PC gaming to the next level? What's going to be important in that time frame? It was, 4K and, virtual reality and, really enabling, PC gamers to have, all of the power, performance, memory bandwidth necessary to get that next user experience.
It's a beast of an engine.
We have a unique and innovative liquid cooling design, and that enables high performance in a cool and quiet package.
When you look at graphics, it's always memory starved. You have to feed those graphics engines with tremendous amounts of graphics data.
Memory bandwidth drives the experience that you can deliver.
Look at the last 10 years, we've been using graphics DDR. It's a great memory technology, but
it's getting a little long in the tooth, and we needed something new that would provide a huge advance in bandwidth.
What we've done at AMD is design a new approach to memory technology. We've worked with the industry to come up with a way to bring this memory into the graphics engines at a much lower power and a much smaller space.
We've been working on high bandwidth memory for over 5 years, and over the past couple of years, really putting it into production with Fiji, together with our partners.
It's an incredibly innovative technology that's gonna revolutionize how we build microprocessors and all silicon devices in the future.
4K gaming and all your favorite games, a virtual reality experience in this small package, that's cool.
Very fine indeed. So, to introduce the world's fastest graphics card, the first graphics card made with HBM, the Fiji processor, please welcome to the stage President and CEO of AMD, Dr. Lisa Su.
Woo!
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. Thank you for everyone who's joining us online. Today is a great day for AMD. Today is a great day for gamers. When I think about AMD, what do we stand for? We stand for building great products. It's as simple as that. It's all about the product. And I couldn't be happier today than to be here to talk to you about our Fiji series of products. When you think about Fiji, you heard it on the video. Fiji is the most complex and the most highest performance GPU we have ever built. It has incredible technology. It has the first with high bandwidth memory. But today, we're not just talking about a chip. We are talking about the products. And it's not just about one product. It's about a family of products that we're building with Fiji. Because when we think about GPUs and gamers, we think about every aspect that's important. What we're trying to do is really satisfy the spectrum. So it's about performance, it's about power, it's about power efficiency, it's about new form factors and what we can bring to PC gaming and things as beautiful as this. So without further ado, let me start first with introducing our family. The AMD Radeon Fury X. Take a look over here. We have two stations running 5K, 45 frames per second, high speed, as well as 60 frames per second Tomb Raider at the ultra high speeds. What you see is perfect gaming for 4K and 5K, really enabled by our Fury X. This is a beautiful card. This is the first one that you're going to see with high bandwidth memory. And when you think about what we're enabling here, it is 1.5x performance per watt over the R9-290X. 1.5x performance per watt. This is an enthusiast gaming card. We're also introducing, along with the Fury X, the Fury, which will be an air-cooled version. The Fury X is a liquid-cooled version. The Fury is an air-cooled version. And you'll see that family in stores very, very shortly. Now, I said we wanted to do more than just introduce the first high-bandwidth memory card. We wanted to take the high-bandwidth memory technology and really innovate on form factor. HBM is special because it gives you not only power and performance, but it also allows you to reduce your board space. So today, for the very first time, I'm going to show you the Radeon R9 Nano. Is this a beautiful card? What you see in the R9 Nano is Fiji with high bandwidth memory in a 6-inch card with more performance, significantly more performance, than the R9-290X at half the size and half the power. 2x performance per watt. This is what we've been able to achieve in this form factor. I can say for sure the Nano is creating a class of its own for high-performance GPUs. A class of its own, and it'll be available this summer along with the Fury and the Fury X. I like this card a lot. This is a great card. But not only that, we said it's a family. And to complete the family, we need the entire spectrum. So Chris talked to you earlier about what we have been able to do in terms of form factors. We are introducing the absolute highest performance graphics card, bar none, in a dual Fiji card, which you see in systems like this one, powering the Quantum computer on stage. It's an incredible lineup, four cards with Fiji, with HBM, really looking at the entire spectrum of graphics performance for all of the experiences that we need. Now, the cards are beautiful. What's more beautiful is what's inside in the technology. So with that, I'm going to invite three very special people to come up on stage. Guys? Joe Macri, our product CTO. Raja Kaduri, our graphics CTO. And Chris Hook, our product manager. So, guys, it's been years since we've been working on this technology. It is an incredible day that we can actually talk about it. So, let's talk about the technology. Raja, you're the chief architect behind our GPU roadmap. Tell us about the Fiji GPU. What were you and the team thinking when you built it?
Sure, Lisa. First off, I'm really, really happy and excited to be here among many friends in the PC gaming community and with the friends on the stage. This is the best group of people to be hanging out with. Lisa, a couple of years ago, Joe came to me and really excited, really animated, and some of you have seen how excited Joe gets. Said, "Hey, I think we can make this new cool memory technology into a product that." He and the team has been working for several years. And when Joe is excited about memory, we really take it seriously. If you remember, right, we, ATI, AMD, were the first to 20 gigabytes per second graphics memory bandwidth. We were the first to introduce 256-bit memory interface into GPUs in 2002. And 6 years later, in 2008, we came up with GDDR5. We were the first to GDDR5 and the first 100 gigabytes per second memory bandwidth. And now, half a terabyte per second memory bandwidth with HBM, we were excited. Then we said, we got to create something incredible with this technology, right? Something new. And so when we looked at the memory bandwidth available and also what it brought to the table, we said, we got to innovate in form factors. We want machines like this with incredible horsepower, no compromise. So we scaled the engine up to match the memory bandwidth that Joe provided. We focused on power efficiency to be able to fit the incredible horsepower into form factors like this. And we also anticipated 4K transition by this time frame. And we focused on tuning the whole pipeline for the 4K experience.
That's
what happened, Lisa, the last 2 years.
That's 4K. Fantastic, Raja. So tell us about some of the numbers. Everyone wants to know the numbers.
Absolutely. So let's talk first about the engine. I mentioned we scaled up 1.5 times, and Lisa mentioned 1.5 times more performance than our previous generation. So the Fury X has 4K streams processor. Right, about 50% higher than the 290X. And that makes up 8.6 teraflops. And packs incredible 8.9 billion transistors. Right, that's the beast of an engine that we build to match the memory bandwidth.
And when you think about power, what were we able to do on power?
So on power, we attacked several areas. The first was microarchitecture improvements from the GCN architecture. We advanced the GCN architecture for power efficiency. We've done an incredible job with power management. And last but not least, you have seen the nano board that Lisa held did phenomenal improvements on the board design side, on the thermals, on the regulators, and variety of other things that we'll talk in detail later to get to that 1.5x per watt on Fury X. Our board design team, and I'd like to give a shout out to them, they went beyond the goal of 1.5x per watt. They created the nano SKU with 2x per watt. Incredible, right? Twice the performance and power efficiency over our last big GPU.
And Raja, most important though for gamers, the experiences.
Absolutely. So the last but not the least aspect, which is the actual experience. So Fiji is in many ways the first product we focused on where we reorganized our entire performance tuning effort, from pre-silicon to post-silicon, completely focused on 4K gaming experience. And we went beyond just tracking benchmarks. Tracking what the reviewers run, tracking just the resolutions that the reviewers look at. We looked at end-to-end, and we had our software team and our pre-silicon hardware teams focused on these titles that are demanding at 4K ultra resolution. And I'm really, really pleased to announce that we have quite a number of titles that are demanding that can play really smoothly on Fiji at 4K ultra resolution.
It's an incredible GPU. You look a little excited.
Yes, I do, Lisa.
Now, to compete for the excitement, though, is Joe. So, yeah. Joe, talk a little bit about high bandwidth memory and the journey that we've been on.
Well, it started 7 years ago. We gathered some of our best at AMD to focus on what problems did we want to solve with memory. Because an engineer, that's the first step of the process. You find the problem, and then we could solve almost anything. And when we looked at what was possible in lithography, architecture, the bandwidths that would be needed, we knew we had some problems. Power would go up, and board area would go up. And so we decided to focus on those two things, bandwidth per watt and bandwidth per millimeter squared. If we could solve those, we could build a machine just like this.
And Joe, talk about Radeon R9 Fury X and how we utilize HBM.
Yeah, our approach was totally different. We decided to go 3D, not just 2D, right? So we changed our approach. The specs we hit were amazing. We went wide. So our bus width went from 512 bits in the previous generation to 4K bits. We doubled we 50% increased our bandwidth, and we did it at 5x reduction in bandwidth per watt. Absolutely amazing. And then we reduced board area by 19x. This is just astounding, and the engineers, they exceeded my goals. But more importantly, we had a couple that really stood out, and Brian Black was really the heart of our 3D efforts. And he exhibited a property that makes us most proud. I call it engineering courage. He started back in 2002 on the die stacking technology. And that means he spent most of his professional career working on one technology. That's courage.
Fantastic, Joe. Now, if you think about HBM, though, this is one step. What's next for HBM?
Well, we're going to take it to more discrete GPUs. We'll take it across the product line in upcoming generations. But it doesn't stop there. APUs, servers, supercomputers. HBM is literally going to transform the computing world. It's going to be everywhere.
And it's really something that we believe in, which is invest in basic technology, ensure that we get it to market, and then keep innovating on it. So, without a doubt, we're really excited about it. Now, Raja, you're not going to let Joe show you up, are you? What are you going to do in graphics?
So, Lisa, I've been building GPUs for 20 years now. And I must say, I've never been more excited about the next 5 years than the last 20 years. We are in an incredible moment of time right now. The way the display technology is advancing, you know, high-resolution displays, 4K, 8K, we have high dynamic range displays. We have VR fundamentally disrupting many, many things in graphics. It's incredible time that we live in. And you know, if you just take a look at where VR is today, and you'll experience it upstairs later after after this session, you know, we have 2K resolution per eye, 90 hertz, and the GPU engine that we just announced, 8 teraflops. But people are already talking about 16K per eye tomorrow, in a few years. Refresh rates of over 120 hertz. You need a petaflop engine, if you do the math, right, to maintain smooth frame rate. Someone at Google, tweeted a couple of days ago, Nate Brown. He says, VR is at least a decade of job security for GPU designers like me. So, I'm really happy, and I'm looking forward to designing, more powerful engines, Lisa. If and PC gamers have been really, really, good to us, and we are really, really thankful for being part of that. This excitement that adopts, these amazing new technologies in display and graphics that come about every year.
Raja, by the way, tells me all the time that he has more than enough to do for the next 10 years. So now everybody knows. So look, this is great technology, and it tells you what we're about at AMD. But let's talk more about the Fury X product and what's in the product and what makes it special.
What I get really excited about is build quality. And look at this, black nickel metallic exoskeleton with soft touch side panels. I mean, I get excited about the industrial design, and the team just knocked this out of the park.
Dude, 7 years, and you talk about the outside. I mean, that's 6 inches long. 2x the performance per watt. The bigger one, we put a 500-watt cooling solution on the bigger one. We only burn 275 watts on average in the board. Keep the die at 50 degrees C, 15 dBs quieter. That's what makes an engineer just smile like you can't believe.
Well, Joe, I got to keep you honest here. As a marketer, you're missing the best part of the board, and that's the illuminated Radeon logo. But also, look at the VU meter that we've got in there, the GPU TAC that shows the window-facing GPU TAC, 8 user-configurable LEDs that shows you GPU load in real time. That's a feature that I'm really excited about.
Yeah, but we built these for the overclockers, for the gamers. We got a 6-phase, 400 amps of power. It's amazing. You're going to be able to overclock this thing like no tomorrow with the cooling solution. This is an overclocker's dream.
Guys, stop fighting, right? It's like you're describing a Ferrari, okay? It's beautiful on the outside and a beast inside, right?
You got it.
I think you'd agree on that. Right?
I think we would.
Okay.
You know what it's like to be an engineer at AMD now, all right? This is exactly what it's like. Okay, let's talk about the important thing. When can gamers get their hands on this technology?
Well, Lisa, it's not much longer. On the 24th of June, the Fury X is going to be on store shelves for $649. And on July 14th, the Fury will be on store shelves for $549.
And I'll finish that with the R9 Nano you'll see later this summer, and the dual Fiji as well you'll see in the fall. So this is our family. We wanted to share with you the incredible innovation that's possible when you have smart people who really have a goal to satisfy every gamer's dream. That's who we are at AMD. We're incredibly pleased to be able to share this technology with you, and it really is a great day. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, we said we had one more thing for you, and I'm going to bring Richard back to give you that one last thing. Richard?
Lisa, thank you so much. Thank you very much indeed. So I hope you can see through all of this our absolutely total, unrelenting commitment to gaming on PC just such a big part of the focus for this company, and leadership like you have never seen. Extraordinary, extraordinary achievement. Okay, so we want one more thing. We want a closing piece of software to wrap this all up. And I would put some suspense into it, but I've already told you what the title is, so I might as well just get to it. We're going to talk now about Star Wars Battlefront, about a lovely partnership that's coming between AMD and Electronic Arts, something that will absolutely use the horsepower of this 8.5 teraflop beast, this creature with unprecedented, absolutely unprecedented horsepower, or should I say, force power. Come on, you all wanted that pun in there somewhere, didn't you? So here to show off Star Wars Battlefront is Lena Ingsfardottir, a senior producer at Electronic Arts DICE. Lena, welcome to the stage. Lena, thank you.
Thank you.
So, to my mind, Battlefront is unarguably the most anticipated game of 2015. Ever since I had small children, I used to lie to them and tell them I was a Jedi out battling the Sith at night. And I am so looking forward to this game. How's the reception going so far?
Well, it's been absolutely incredible, the reception that we've had. And bringing it here, showing the gameplay that we showed yesterday and we're showing here today, it's been an amazing experience.
Good, good, good. So what is it that you're trying to achieve with this game?
Well, one of the things that's been so great about this project is the partnership that we have with Lucasfilm. And we've been to the archives. We revealed the game 2 months ago at Star Wars Celebration. And being able to be there with the fans at an event like Star Wars Celebration and seeing the appreciation and seeing the love that people have for Star Wars is incredible. And what we're trying to achieve is that, you know, what you probably had and what I had as a kid, I want players to be able to fulfill their Star Wars battle fantasies. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to bring players into the world, into that galaxy far, far away, in a way that they've never been able to before.
Okay, and there's a sense of realism that you're striving towards here, which is, I would say, unprecedented as well. You're building using the Frostbite engine, which I've loved and respected for over a decade, I guess, now. How much of an effort are you having to put in to get realism?
Well, we are quite a stickler for detail at DICE. So we've been working with our partners at Lucasfilm. And one of the amazing things about working on a project like this is the access that they've given us to the props from the original trilogy of movies. So we've gone to Skywalker Ranch, we've gone to the archives, we've been able to walk around and look at the lightsabers and Darth Vader's helmets and the costumes. And yeah, I know, it's a hard job, someone has to do it. And no, but that's obviously they've given us amazing access and that's what we're doing because we strive for the authenticity. We really want to recreate that universe in a way that as I said before, we can bring players back or bring players into that world. So we're trying to deliver the most authentic Star Wars experience ever.
Okay, and to get that really authentic experience, what do you need in terms of graphics horsepower?
Well, DICE obviously is a studio that has a very strong PC heritage and a strong pedigree, and so. You know, the original founders of DICE were a part of the modding scene back in the 80s, and that PC heritage is something that, as a studio, we're incredibly proud of. And we strive, going forward, we want to keep that, keep up the good work. And so we're super happy to be partnering with AMD and being able to take advantage of that amazing hardware to deliver the best gaming, the PC gaming experience going forward. And as I said before, I mean, we have this focus on authenticity and being able to bring players into the world. And then we have an incredibly talented team at DICE. We have amazing artists and engineers that are, doing their absolute best. And it helps when it's Star Wars and everyone loves it. And they really, want to bring that extra effort into it. And of course, then we have the Frostbite engine, which is also an amazing platform to work with. And we're using tools and technology such as photogrammetry, which enables us basically to take these props at the archives and bring them into a game at the level of fidelity that you haven't seen before. So I say that bringing all of this together, the partnership with AMD, the quality of the team at DICE, this access for an amazing, what I think is an amazing 4K PC experience.
It is indeed. It is indeed. Okay, so before E3, no one had ever seen the PC version running out there in the wild. You brought some footage along for us to take a look at.
Yes,
who would
I
like
did.
To see that now? I can't hear you. Who would like to see that now? Come on. Absolutely. Okay, let's take a look. Thing of great beauty. Thank you very much. Okay, so I guess the last question is, when can I get it? And I don't mean as chief gaming scientist, can I have a copy tomorrow, please? I mean, when can I, as a PC gamer, expect to be able to buy this?
As a PC gamer, you will be able to buy this on November 17th this year. And you'll be happy to know that you'll be able to preload the game on Origin days before. So actually, the minute the game is available, you'll be able to start playing. And next month, also at San Diego Comic-Con, you will be able to play it on PC as a part of the AMD Gaming Experience and Zach Levi's Nerd HQ.
Superb, superb. Okay, now, nobody's listening. As chief gaming scientist, can I get a key now, please?
You might be. Let's talk about that after the show.
Okay, Lena, let's do that. Lena, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you very much for showing us this footage. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we have seen a lot. We've seen some really impressive stuff. We've seen the biggest players in PC gaming, in Microsoft, in Oculus, in EA. We've seen the fastest graphics card in the world. We've seen a dual Fiji design with HBM, high bandwidth memory. We've seen the AMD R9 Fury X, and we've seen the Radeon R9 Fury, the most advanced and innovative graphics cards ever built using this revolutionary Fiji processor. You've seen the world's most power-efficient class graphics card in the AMD R9 Nano, squeezing an unbelievable amount of performance into just 6 inches. You've seen the next best-gen DX12 gaming at 4K and unbelievable VR in the AMD Radeon R9 300 series. Tremendous spread of exciting stuff that we've taken a look at today. We've seen leading performance and features for the best online gaming in esports with the R7 300 series. What a great morning. Well, the live cast is pretty much at a close now, so join us, please, at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern. That's around 9 a.m. for our friends in Asia. And if you're really hardcore, if you're from Europe like me, 3 a.m., stay up for it. Then you'll be able to see the PC Gamer press conference at pcgamingshow.com. Then you'll get even more incredible PC games that we know you're all excited about, and we'll talk more about this entire family of Fiji products. In the meantime, join us, please, at amd.com/graphics to learn all about the new Radeon graphics card lineup that we've rolled out today. And stay tuned on this stream, if you're watching on Twitch, to see AMD put our next-gen Radeon cards to the test. We'll be streaming here for the next 23 hours, showing off incredible games and giving away lots of prizes, including one or two of these latest graphics cards. I want to thank you all for tuning in. We will see you online. And I promised you a really painful pun. That's how I'm going to close, because I'm expecting to be booed off the stage for this. But this Fiji has utterly blown me away. It's designed for 4K gaming. It has an astonishing 4K memory interface, 4 kilobits of memory, just amazing. And it has an equally amazing 4,096 stream processors. Buy yourself a Fiji. May the fours be with you. Thank you so much. Ooh. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. We are done here now today.
We've worked with AMD from the beginning. We've worked really closely with their engineers, and I think the final result really shows that.
I've been working with an engineer helping us to improve performance. He knows the AMD GPU inside out.
When we were first looking at, can we get this to 4K? And we were struggling for a while to get it up there, and then we turned Mantle on and got that support, and then it just works.
At those kinds of resolutions, the last barriers to any sorts of immersion fall away and feel like you're in a picture.
We're showing Crescent Bay, which is our flagship prototype that is demonstrating the promise of VR. We're showing this on the flagship Radeon graphics chipset.
AMD is uniquely positioned to actually deliver the promise of VR over the coming years because we have the right DNA to do that.
The nice thing about the AMD stuff is if it isn't 4K for you, it could be Infinity. You might have multiple lower resolution monitors at home.
This is Ashes of Singularity, and it's a new strategy game we're working on. So thanks to Mantle and as well as DirectX 12, we're going to see completely new classes of games that we can't even imagine.